I've been given the task this morning to also introduce our next speaker. Kim Hodes knows about success. She took a kitchen table hobby and turned it into a seven-figure business. Despite being a former high school teacher with zero business experience, she combines the lessons she learned along the way with a fresh perspective on life to give an original and inspirational slant on success, happiness, health, and staying motivated so you can live life to the fullest. To put Kim in a box is impossible, but to try and sum her up, here goes. She inspires thousands of people each year. She speaks for hundreds of organizations and companies annually. She's spoken to just about every major industry. She is requested by Fortune 100 companies. She is nationally known on topics of work-life balance, leadership for women, communication, networking, the old-fashioned way, face-to-face, productivity, and getting more out of what you want out of life. She's also a best-selling author, an award-winning businesswoman, a yoga instructor, and God bless her, the mother of five. People get Kim, and Kim gets people. Bottom line, get ready. Kim is a fearless, no-nonsense speaker with a unique perspective and strategies that actually work in the real world. Please help me welcome Kim Hodes.
Thank you. There was this older gentleman, and he was worried that his wife was going deaf because she just wasn't listening to him anymore. He was at the doctor, and he said, "Doc, what do I do?" And the doctor said, "Well, start at the far side of the room, ask her a question, and see how close you have to get before she hears you." So when he got home, it was perfect. She was over at the sink working on dinner. So he walks in, "Honey, what's for dinner?" No answer. He gets a little closer. "Honey, what's for dinner?" No response. He gets up right behind her. "Honey, what's for dinner?" She turns around and says, "Meatloaf, I've told you three times." But doesn't that happen? Has that happened to anybody besides me in life? There's a problem and we think, oh, the problem's out there, the problem's with them. But guess what? We can't control what happens out there. We can't control what happens with them. And I'm sure you, a lot of you as travel planners, know that more than anyone. There are so many circumstances we cannot control. But there is one thing we can always control, and that is ourselves. And that's good news. You know, if there was, now I know my picture's up here, but let's just say there was a movie playing up here. And let's say that it was a scary movie. It was a movie we did not want to watch. If you wanted to change the movie, okay, if we just brought in a sheet and put the sheet in front of that screen, would the movie change? No. How would you change the movie? You'd have to go to the projector, right? You'd have to put in a different film. Well, we are the projector of our own lives. So we get to control the movie that plays out in our world. Whoop, whoop. Okay, let me tell you how this works. Now, men, I might lose you for just a second. Women, you'll be right with me. You know in the movie Pretty Woman, when she's at the polo match and she's got on the, I love women, they're all going, the great brown dress with the white polka dots, and she goes, whoop, whoop. Well, that's where this came from. Men, you'll just have to play along, okay? You'll get your moment later. All right, so how it works is I go, whoop, whoop, and then right after, you guys go, whoop, whoop. So let's practice. Whoop, whoop. Now that was pretty good, but we are in the great state of Arkansas, and so we're gonna all play along. So here we go, let's do it one more time, as loud as you can. Whoop, whoop. Yeah, good job, all right. We are gonna have some fun today, and we're gonna learn a few things. How many of you need more fun in your lives? How many of you know a few people who need to learn a few things? Yeah, I thought so. All right, everybody stand up. All right, bring your right hand up, right hand down. Left hand up, left hand down. Right hand up, keep it up. Left hand up, keep it up. Bring them together and clap. All right, now bring them together and clap three times. All right, now on the count of three, I want you to clap seven times as fast as you can. One, two, three. Oh, a standing ovation already? I'm just kidding. You guys are fun. I want to travel with you. Yeah. No, actually, that standing ovation is not for me, but it is for somebody in this room. Miss Teresa, if you'll come up here. Teresa, come up here. She is the one who has put this entire event together. I have a little present for her. Come up here and let's recognize her and Boomers and Groups for putting this whole event together. Come on up here. Come on. Good job. All right, thank you. Here's one of my signature white stone bracelets. It's a little thank you for allowing me to be with this great group.
Thank you very
so
much.
Thank you for being here. All right. Thank you. You can have a seat. All right. So, all right, got to keep track of the time here. Everything's perfect, even when it's not. You know, some people don't believe that. There is actually a group, millions, millions and millions and millions of people who totally get the concept. Every single day when they get up, they cannot wait for their feet to hit the floor. They're excited about what adventure life holds. They are ready for whatever finds them. They can find good in anything. Do you know what all those people have in common? They're under the age of 5. Yes, children are our teachers, and that's why I had to have 5. I had a lot to learn. I had to have more than just a couple. Yeah, everything's perfect. You know, we don't live in a culture that supports this philosophy. CNN is the most widely broadcast station in the world. CNN is 100% bad news. I turned it on last night just to double check. They've not changed their format. It's all negative. You know, research was done by Psychology Today, and they found that 85% of the information that we are exposed to is negative. So we are bombarded culturally with negative, 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 negative. But if we want to live a life that feels perfect, we want to find the good in everything that happens, we've got to quit looking for the negative. Because you know what else our culture does? Even if things are good, they send us the doom and gloom that it will not last. Let me know. I want you to just play along with me, and if you can finish any of these sentences, please do so. You better save money for a rainy day. You better hope the other shoe doesn't drop. This is too good to? Yes, too good to be true. So we even get the message, if things do get good, don't get too comfortable because it may not last. And you know, you're either singing one song or the other. You're either singing the song that life is perfect, good things happen, things always work out, there's some good that comes from it. Or you're singing the song that life is hard, nothing's fair, it just doesn't work out. And you can only sing one song or the other. And I'm gonna prove it to you. Do we have anybody here whose birthday it is today? Do we have anybody who has a birthday this week? All right, come on up. Come on up. All right. Come right up here. Now, you guys are all going to stand up, and we are going to sing happy birthday to her, okay? Now, this is going to be a happy birthday like you've never gotten before, okay? Tell us your name.
Esther.
Esther, and where are you from?
From Houston.
Houston, and what do you do in the travel world?
I'm an inbound receptive operator, and I plan group tours.
She plans group tours. I got that part. All right, so your job is to stand here, right here. Okay. Open your hands, and you guys are going to sing her happy birthday. Her name's Esther, okay? So let's let her have it.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, dear Esther. Happy birthday to you.
Woo! All right. Here's a little birthday present. Thank you for volunteering. As she makes her way back to her seat, let's sing Row, Row, Row Your Boat.
Row, row, row your boat gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream.
All right, now I want you to sing both songs at once. Ready, set, go. You can't do it, can you? You cannot sing two songs at once. You're either singing the song that life is good and things work out and there's a lesson to learn, or you're singing the song that life's not fair and nothing works out. Thank you. You can have a seat. Let me tell you why it matters. Why it matters which song we're singing. One reason is because when we are looking for the good in things and when we're looking to find ways that things always work out, life gets bigger and more opportunities present themselves. And when we come from the place that life is small and things and we need to be afraid and things don't work out, life gets smaller. And how many of you would much rather live a big life than a small life? You want a big life? Yeah. Whoop, whoop. All right, yeah. Here's the other reason that it matters. Whatever we start out with, we end up with. If we are going to make a pie and we start out with apples, what kind of pie are we going to get? It's impossible to get a peach pie when you start out with apples. Just like if we're going to plant a tree and we plant an acorn, we are going to get an oak tree. It's impossible not to. And it is the same with our thoughts and our words. Whatever we start out with, if we start out with positivity and looking for the good, we're going to find more positive and more things to feel good about. And if we start out with negative, have you ever had one of those days that starts out bad, you get up on the wrong side of the bed, and it just builds on itself, doesn't it? By the end of the day, you think, I'm just going home and getting back in bed and starting over tomorrow. Yeah. Because whatever we start out with, we end up with. And especially with our words have power. I am amazed. I don't know if you guys have ever heard this. People who say, oh, I always get sick this time of year. I look at them, I think, I bet you do. Yeah. I met a woman recently and she said, I just cannot lose weight after having a baby. I've had five. I understand. I said, oh my gosh, how old's your baby? She said, oh, well, he's in college now. I was like, oh, sorry, sugar. Can't use that one anymore. And then I hear this all over the country. I'm no good at remembering names. Have you guys heard somebody say that? Yeah, I think of course you're not. You're programming your mind to not be good at remembering names. Our words have power, positive or negative. And again, I want to give you a visual demonstration of this, so I need another volunteer. We'll volunteer. All right, come on up. That was pretty reluctant, but I appreciate it. Let's give him a round of applause. All right, Keith, yes. Tell everybody where you're from.
From Minneapolis.
Minneapolis?
Yes.
Oh, I was just there. My daughter lives there.
Oh, wow.
Great city. I have had a wonderful time. We rented bikes and it's fabulous. Yay. All right, what do you do there?
I work for a company called GoNext. We provide travel programs.
Travel programs if you want to go ride bikes in Minneapolis? Meet Keith. All right, so Keith, you're going to stand in front of me.
Okay.
I want you to put this arm up right out here, and I'm going to try to push it down. I want you to resist, okay? Okay, so now I want you to say, I love my life. Life is great. Everything always works out.
I love my life. Life is great. Everything works out.
Okay, put your arm back up. Okay, now I want you to say, I hate my life. Nothing ever works out for me. Life is not fair.
I hate my life. Nothing ever works out for me. Life isn't fair.
Okay, put your arm out. No, resist. Yeah, yeah. Okay, now I want you to just listen to my words. Keith, I am so glad you're here. It is awesome you made the trip from Minneapolis, and we are all blessed by your presence in this place. Thank you. All right, put your arm out. Okay. Now remember, he volunteered, okay? And he gets a present at the end of it, okay? It probably would have been better for everybody if you'd stayed home. I really wish you hadn't been able to make this trip, and I'm sorry, we've got to all put up with you. Okay, put your arm out. Resist. Yeah, yeah. Okay, you want it to get even weirder? All right, we're not going to even use any words. I want you just all to send him positive energy. No words, just send him positive energy. All right, put your arm up there. Resist. Okay, remember he volunteered. Send him negative energy. I know it's hard, but do it. Help me out here. Okay, sorry, you volunteered. Yeah. You can feel it, can't you? Okay, put your arm up. Do you get what this means? Everything we say to ourselves, everything we say to other people, our coworkers, the people that we, our clients, our customers, our children, our spouses, and everything we think about them, not even using words, strengthens or weakens people. Everything we say or think either builds people up or it tears them down. Let's give him really positive energy, and I've got a present for you. My Little Book of Quotes. Thank you so much. Big round of applause. Thank you. Everything we say and think is either going to build up or tear down the people around us. My husband and I have kind of a fun story. My life feels like it's perfect. I had a great childhood. I had a lot of fun in that. My daddy was a minister and my mom a school teacher. And I was told from the time I was this high that I was going to grow up and be a school teacher. So that's what I did. About my third year in the classroom, I started getting in trouble. I was getting called to the principal's office more often than my students. I mean, they'd come in with a pink slip and my kids would rib each other and they'd be like, oh, it's for Mrs. H. I'd be like, ah. So I decided to leave teaching. I had 4 kids in 5 years. So I wasted no time in creating another full-time job for myself. Just didn't get paid quite as well. It was when I was a stay-at-home mom that I started making little beaded bracelets at my kitchen table. Because I say I lead a charmed life and I'm always in the right place at the right time, that little kitchen table hobby turned into a million-dollar business. And I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that later. Because of that success, I've been able to author 4 books, and I get to travel around the country speaking to groups like this, and I do some one-on-one executive coaching. I am happily married to a total hottie. We've been together 28 years, and I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that interesting story, too. And on top of that, on top of a family I love, and on top of a man I love, on top of work I love, I also have a really deep and rich inner life of my own, a life completely independent from those. I'm a yoga instructor. I have a boat on Lake Washita. Now, Lake Washita is here in Hot Springs. In fact, I'm going to go there as soon as I leave. And if you have not seen Hot Springs, talk to one of these women from Arkansas, because Lake Washita is the second cleanest lake in the United States to Lake Tahoe. It's amazing. I have my own boat, and every summer, I spend 7 days completely alone on an island in my boat, totally alone. I always come home and say to my family, I really love you guys. That's like the 7 best days of my year. So my life really feels sweet right now. What I'm going to share with you today are some of the ways that, some of the strategies I've used to build this life that I really, really love. Whoop, whoop.
Whoop, whoop.
All right, come on. Whoop, whoop.
Whoop, whoop.
All right. So my husband and I, we've been together 28 years on and off, and we had a personal tragedy, and we could not heal from that tragedy, and so we ended up getting divorced, and then we got back together 2 years later. And when we were divorced, he went for counseling. And when he went to counseling, when he got done with the counselor, his very last visit with the counselor said, I would like to meet Kim. I want you to bring her in. We were getting married like the next week. So I go in to meet Dr. Phillip. Dr. Phillip is about 80 years old. He had been a university professor for 50 years, and now he did counseling on the side. So we go in and we sit down with Dr. Phillip, and he says, I'm going to tell you both a story. I said, okay. And so he starts to tell this story. He says, there were 2 women. One of them was very happily married. She loved her husband and had a good relationship. The other woman did not get along very well with her husband and was not very happy in her marriage. Well, the woman who was not very happy in her marriage was really tired of hearing about how great this woman's husband was. So she said to her friend, why don't you for just 1 week keep a journal of everything he does that irritates you, every time you have to ask him to do something twice, every time he does not listen to you, just keep a journal of that and then come back and see me in a week. So her friend agreed that she would do that. When she came back a week later, sure enough, she had about 5 or 6 pages of things her husband had done that irritated her. Dr. Phillip looked my husband straight in the eye and he said, Robert, do you know why I've told you this story? And all I could think was, I'm so glad he didn't pick me because I had no idea. It's like, my husband said, no, Dr. Phillip, I'm not sure why you told me. And Dr. Phillip said, because, Robert, everything you look for in Kim, you will find. And if you look for the good, you will find plenty of evidence of that. And if you look for the bad, you will find plenty of evidence of that. And that's how it is in everything in life. Everything in life, if we look for the good, we'll find the good. And if we look for the bad, we'll find the bad. How we create a life that's perfect even when it's not is to always look for the good in every circumstance. We've got patterns that need to be broken. See, we're living in a culture that has trained us to look for the negative. So I want to see how you guys are with patterns. So stand up. Got a few little exercises to give you. All right. So bring your right hand all the way over your head. Bring it to the side. Bring it down. Left hand up in front of you. Make a fist. Bring it to your chin. Bring it to your chin. Ah, some of you are doing the slide, yeah. Okay, well, I know who my visual learners are. Okay, let's try another one. I'm just gonna tell you a story. Okay, tell you a story. You're a bus driver. At the first stop, a woman with a red coat gets on. At the second stop, a man carrying a green bag gets off. And at the third stop, two little boys with soccer balls get on. What did the bus driver have for breakfast? It's in there. Okay, I'm gonna tell the story again. I'm just gonna emphasize one word. You are a bus driver. So what did the bus driver have for breakfast? Eggs, yeah. I think y'all had the same thing, right? Okay, one more. Here we go. Here we go, get excited. Come on, just shake something. Come on, get excited. All right. So here we go. It's just going to be a math problem. This is for all you men, okay? The analytical math problem. All right, take 1,000 and add 40. Add to that another 1,000 plus 30. Add to that another 1,000 plus 20. Add one more 1,000 plus 10. Shout out your answer. Guess what? It's 4,100. 1,000 plus 40 is 1,040. Another 1,000 plus 30 is 2,070. Another 1,000 plus 20, 3,090. Another 1,000 plus 10, 4,100. I bet you in my lifetime of speaking, I've done this with 1,000,000 people. And guess what? 98% get 5,000. Why? Because our brain works in certain ways. Go ahead and have a seat. Our brain works in certain ways. I gotta have a sip of water. There are patterns that we need to break. One of the patterns that we've also been given besides negativity is this pattern of just accepting whatever life sends us. Ah, it's okay. I'll just take it. Whatever I get's fine. That's one of those patterns we've gotta break. There was a man who was fishing. And every time he caught a fish, he would hold the fish up next to this stick. And if the fish was bigger than the stick, he would throw it back. Well, this little boy was watching him, and he went over and he's like, "Hey, mister, how come you keep throwing the big ones back?" And the guy said, "Well, this stick is the size of my frying pan." But don't we often do that in certain ways? We go, "Oh, you know, we got to dream big. You guys are in the dream. You're in the dream business." Do you know for how many people travel's on their bucket list? You're in the dream business. And so, but so often we decide, oh, this is what my dream can be because this is how much money I make or this is the level of education I have. We find all kinds of ways to limit ourselves to the size of our frying pan. Now, there are all kinds of people who did not let their current circumstances dictate their dream. Think about Hollywood. Hollywood, we think of movie stars, what? Tall, dark, and handsome. Then think Danny DeVito. Yeah. You think people said, "You are a Hollywood material, honey." And one of my heroes is Muggsy Bogues. Muggsy Bogues is 5'3". That means he comes up to about here on me. He weighs 135 pounds. You can get his stats online. That means I could sit on him and hurt him. Do you know what Muggsy Bogues did? Played basketball in the NBA for 16 seasons, paid over $18 million at 5'3". Do you know how many 5'11 boys there are saying, "Oh, I can't be in the NBA? I can't have my dream because I got the gene that made me not 6 feet tall." Muggsy Bogues was 5'3". I had a dream to build a business. I had a dream to build a $1 million company. Now, I gotta tell you, when I started out, I was on the fast track. My first year, sales were $4,000. Yep. But when I would go to events and people would say to me, what do you do? I would say, my name's Kim Hodes. I'm president and CEO of a million-dollar jewelry company I started at my kitchen table. People would be like, wow. And that's what I would tell them when my sales were $4,000. And I was speaking at an event like this, and afterwards this woman comes up to me and she goes, you're a liar. I said, I'm a liar. She goes, yeah. You told people you had a $1 million business when you didn't. I said, oh, honey, I had a $1 million business. All the money had just not yet arrived. It eventually caught up with me. But there was no evidence around me that I could start a $1 million business. My daddy was a minister. My mom a school teacher. All they wanted for me to do was get a job with benefits, not be an entrepreneur. I had no staff. I had no business plan. I'd never taken a marketing course. But you know what I had? I had a dream. I had a vision for what I could build and what I could create. One day, I got a handwritten letter, and it was shaky handwriting, like it was from an older gentleman. And he said, hey, little lady, I'd like to see your jewelry. Well, didn't have anybody else beating down my door, so I decided I'd give him a call. When I talked to this man, I knew that he knew more about sales. I'd never been in sales. I knew he knew more about sales than I could ever hope to learn. So he invited me to come over and meet him for coffee. So I went over, took my jewelry. He asked me why I was not going to this trade show. It was a trade show for the industry I wanted to break into. And they wouldn't let me in. They probably know why now. No, they wouldn't let me in because you had to have 3 references from within the industry to be allowed to exhibit at the trade show, which made no sense to me because I'm like, how do I get the references if you won't let me in to meet the people? Anyways, he said, you know what? Sit there. I'll get you in. He picks up his rotary dial phone, calls 3 of his buddies, and gets me into the trade show. 6 weeks later, I am on the trade show floor, knees a-knocking, scared to death, my 8 little pieces of jewelry right here, and I left that trade show with $285,000 in orders. In the next 2 years, I parlayed that into over $1 million of business. Well, thank you. Who could write the script for that? I'm going to get a handwritten letter. I'm going to drive across the state and meet this guy. He's going to get me into a trade show. And 3 days later, I'm going to have $285,000 in sales. And 2 years later, I'm going to have a $1 million company. Who could write the script for that? Not me. Not you. See, we spend so much time trying to figure out the how. How we're going to make it happen. The how is not our job. Our job is to have the vision. Do you think the Wright brothers knew how they were going to make a plane fly? No. They just had a dream. They had a vision that they could make it happen. A lot of people don't know this, but the Wright brothers' father was a very conservative minister. And he felt that if God had wanted people to fly, he would have given them wings. He truly believed his sons were going to burn in hell for all eternity if they created a flying machine. The Wright brothers had to eventually move out of their home and defy their father's wishes to follow their dream. There might be people who will tell you that your dream's impossible too. Don't let them. Don't let them win. All right. Whoop, whoop. Okay. I'm going to give you 3 more ways that you can find the good in everything. How much time we got? Good deal. But you can find the good in everything and you can live a life that's perfect. The first one is called 10 by 40. 10 by 40. 10 by 40 is that for 10 minutes a day, for the next 40 days, I want you to put positive, motivational, inspirational information into your brain. Now, I'm not asking you to find an extra 10 minutes in your day. Anybody here already feel like they're stretched to the limit? Anybody here? Am I the only one? Okay. So if you read the newspaper, just replace 10 minutes of that with reading something inspirational. If you watch TV, replace 10 minutes of that with watching inspirational YouTube videos. If you go to my website, kimhodes.com, I have a tracking sheet. I believe what gets monitored gets managed, what gets managed gets done. So track yourself for 40 days. Put positive, uplifting information into your brain. It will begin to change you in the inside. I can't tell you how. Just like, I don't know why water boils at 212 degrees. I don't know why at 211 it's hot water and at 212 degrees it's boiling, but it is. And when we start to feed ourselves positive, uplifting information, something inside of us shifts and we begin to see the world in a new way. The second thing you can do is celebrate all successes. All successes. You know, I love to tell my story of how great my life is, and I put that in there for a reason. Because I want you to think back, because it has happened before. It might not have happened in this room, but sometimes when I'm talking about how great my life is and my hottie husband and my success, there are some people that are not so excited for me. It's true. There are some people who think, I bet it's a lie. I bet she's got a secret. It's true. But you know what? There was a wise Indian shaman who said, our subconscious mind cannot tell the difference between criticism of another and criticism of oneself. Anything we block for somebody else, we block for ourselves. But in the same light, anything we celebrate for others, anything we lift others up for, we also lift ourselves up with. So celebrate all successes. And there are two other strategies in my book that dovetail with that. That's one of the strategies in my book. But another one is to allow others to help you and then to give back. See, I allowed Dan, that man, to help me. And then when it was my opportunity, I have given back and mentored so many people who have wanted an opportunity. So I want you to see how this feels in your body. I want you to get the physical experience of it, okay? So I need everybody to find a partner, okay? Now, it's a partner, that's a group of two, okay? Sometimes people want to do a group of three. Partners, two. So everybody find a partner, and you must remember, I am the mother of five, which means I have eyes in front of my head, beside my head, back of my head, and if you think that you can sit this out, I will find you. So if you need a partner, raise your hand, and I will find you one. So stand up and face your partner. And if you need a partner, raise your hand, I'll help find one. Okay, we got someone back here who needs a partner. Right back here, who else needs a partner? Is there anybody? Is there anybody else who needs a partner? You know, right here in the blue? All right, green and blue, right there. Is there anybody else? Everybody got a partner? We got one without a partner? Okay, there's one right there, those two. Do you have a partner? Not yet. Do you have a partner? Right here, you two. Boo, boo. All right, you're coming together. Walk this way. Everybody say, walk this way, walk this way. All right, so I'm going to give you 10 seconds. Pick an A partner and a B partner. A and a B. All right, here we go. Bees, you're going to go first. All right, so Bees, here it is, okay? All you're going to do is you're going to tell A's great things about yourself. You're going to tell them things you do well at work, things, extracurricular activities you're involved in, sports you may do. Just tell them things that you do. Maybe it's being a great dad. Maybe it's you cut the lawn with perfection. It doesn't matter. Just tell them great things that you do. Ready? Just 30 seconds. Ready, set, go. Very good. Now, A's, I want you to look at B's, and I just want you to affirm for them how great they are. Just say, oh my gosh, tell them how wonderful they are. 10 seconds. Ready, set, go. All right, very good. Okay, now, oh, I love it when the hugging starts. All right, now we're going to switch, and A's, you're gonna tell B's wonderful things about you, things that you do great. 30 seconds, ready, set, go. look at A's, I mean, you might have to do the I'm not worthy bout. Just let them know how fabulous they are. Tell them how great they are. Tell them they're fabulous. 10 seconds, ready, set, go. Seat. Do you feel how the energy in this room has shifted? Can you feel the higher vibration? Why is that? It's because we allowed somebody to help us, and then when it was our turn, we gave back. When we allow other people to help us and then we give back, it elevates everybody, just like when we celebrate all successes. Now, another thing that we can do to really create a life that's perfect and find the good in everything is to just take a minute to slow down. Slow down. There is a story out of Boston College. Boston College took their seminary students. They divided them into three groups. They asked for volunteers to participate in a Good Samaritan study. And with these volunteers, they put them in three different groups. They had everybody come to one room on campus. And when they arrived, they said, oh my goodness, we've got to get to another room on the other side of campus. We're running late. Everybody hurry over there right now. What they didn't know was that they put a man in a hooded sweatshirt sitting in the doorway, coughing and moaning on their way. That group, the group that was late, 10% of them stopped to help the gentleman in need. The second group, they did the same thing. They showed up and they said, oh, we need to get over to the other side of campus. We're not late, but we need to get over there right now. Everybody needs to head over there. That group, 43% stopped to help the man in need. The final group, they said, oh, we need to get to the other side of campus. We're running a little bit early. We've got about 15 minutes. Let's just all meet over at that other building in 15 minutes. 65% stopped to help the man in need. If we really want to make a difference in life, we've got to take a breath and slow down so we can see the places where we can make an impact. That's what makes life perfect, when we make a difference every day that we're here. Now, the final thing that you can do to lead a life that you love, lead a perfect life, find the good in everything, is have more fun. Now, most of you raised your hands when I said how many of you need more fun, but here's what has happened, especially in our age group. Do you know that there are some people who wait to laugh until they see something funny? You know what? We can laugh for no reason. We go to the gym. I sit there. My grandpa, he was a lobsterman in Maine, and he would watch people running, and he'd be like, boy, I could give them a workout. But we do that because it's good for us. Laughing has so many benefits, and yet we wait for something to be funny to laugh. Well, I went and I got certified in laughter yoga. Laughter yoga is a series of exercises where you laugh just because it feels good. So we're gonna laugh, everybody up. I promise you, nobody has ever been hurt by participating in these experiences, although I do have to admit there was one woman who wet herself. So, you know, that's the only mishap we've ever had, all right? So when we finish a laughter yoga exercise, we go, very good, yay. So do that with me. Very good, yay. Oh, you guys got that down. Oh, that's fun, do it again. Very good, yay. All right, so we're gonna start off with aloha laughter. Now, let me tell you, the objective is not to try to stop yourself from laughing, because I'll see some people going, You want to laugh, okay? Look at this table, they're already laughing, okay? Follow their lead, okay? So get your hula hands out. Come on, men. You got those hips, let's use them. Shake it, aloha, aloha, aloha. Very good, yay. All right, this is for you men. We're going to do motorbike laughter, so get on your motorcycle. Vroom, vroom, come on, play along. Vroom, vroom, vroom. Very good, very good. Yay, all right, nice job. Thank you, you can have a seat. See, you feel better already, don't you? All right. The other thing you can do is what I call putting some whoop in your day. Just put some whoop in your day. Do something every day that is just going to make life a little more fun. Sometimes I'll only put in one earring. Sometimes I wear shoes that don't match. One day I showed up at work with a hairnet on. Why not? They were like, why do you have on a hairnet? We sell jewelry. I said, just for the heck of it. They can't fire me. Just do something that's going to make your life a little more fun. This is it. We got one life. You got to love it. Amen. Amen. All right. So Henry David Thoreau did an experiment. Why do we do experiments? To see what happens, to prove something. He did an experiment. He said, I went to live in the woods, to front only the essential facts of life, and to see what I might learn from them, and not, when it came time to die, learned that I had not truly lived. Henry David Thoreau went and he lived in the woods for 2 years, 2 months, and 2 days. During that time, he wrote the essay Walden. And at the end of that essay, he says this, I have learned this at least by my experiment, that if one advances confidently in the direction of their dreams, they will meet with a success unexpected in common hours. If one advances confidently in the direction of their dreams, oh, he also put in there, endeavoring to live the life which they have imagined, the life that they have imagined, they will meet with a success unexpected in common hours. He did not say, work 60 hours a week, don't take time to exercise, put work before relationships. No, he said, walk confidently in the direction of your dreams. He did the experiment. Thank goodness, we don't have to. I'm sure there is no Wi-Fi or cappuccino out there in the woods. So go confidently in the direction of your dreams. I've got one final story to tell you. Before I do, I want to let you know that with Boomers and Groups, I made a special deal for you guys. Let me tell you what it is. You can get today, it's only here, two of my books, Show Up, Be Bold, Play Big. This was an Indy Next Generation Book Award of Excellence finalist. It's 33 strategies for success and happiness, and I think you'll really like it. You know why you'll really like it, though? Look, Elshin. Very short. And then I have my book of quotes. How many of you like quotes? Yeah, I love quotes. So this is just my little book of quotes. I took the 13 strategies, and then you get a bookmark that says, whoop, 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 whoop. Yeah, so for you guys today only, all three of those, $200. Just kidding. $20 today only. And you know why it's so important is that you come to events like this, and how many of you feel good right now? How many feel good? Yeah. Whoop, whoop, yeah. You feel good. But you know what? We go back home, we get back in our routines, and those good feelings start to fade. So we need tools that can bring us back up. I love to take my book and just play reading roulette. Just open it to any page and know whatever strategy that lands on is what I needed for that day. So, you know, invest in some things that will help you keep these good feelings going. All right, my final story. It's a very personal story. It's about these white stones. And it's about a time in my life when the circumstances were far, far from perfect. 17 years ago, I lost a 2-year-old daughter to leukemia. As you can imagine, it was the darkest, darkest time in my life. I had 4 children under the age of 5. My son, my youngest son at that time, gave bone marrow on his very first birthday. We fought the fight, and Chelsea didn't make it. And I fell into such a pit of despair, such deep grief and mourning, that I didn't know if I was ever going to make my way out. And all of a sudden, I started seeing smooth white stones everywhere I went. Like, not a pile of them, but one smooth white stone. And it would be like it was like pick me up. So I started to pick them up. And I would take them home, and I felt somehow that it was a message from my daughter, Chelsea. Well, this went on for about 6 months, and at this point, I had a huge pile of white stones on my dresser. My husband, who was frankly worried about me with probably good reason, was like, "What is it with you and these white stones?" And I said, "I don't know, but I feel like there is a message from Chelsea in there somewhere." Well, about 6 months later, we're at church. We had a guest pastor that Sunday, and she was preaching on the story of David and Goliath. And she says, "You know, we talk about the story of David and Goliath, and you know, everybody knows David's the underdog. And of course, Goliath represents, you know, those huge challenges in our lives, those things that we think we can't defeat. Maybe it's a financial crisis, or maybe it's a health challenge, or maybe it's a failed relationship. You know, David represents those things that it just feels like we can't win over." She says, "But what nobody ever really talks about are the smooth white stones that David used to slay Goliath." And in that moment, she had my full attention, because I knew what she was going to say next was not words for her sermon. I knew that it was Chelsea's message for me. And she said, "Those smooth white stones represent our ability to slay any giant in our lives, to overcome anything that seems like we cannot defeat it, to remember that we have within us the strength and the power to overcome anything." And I knew that's what Chelsea was saying to me. "Mom, you can beat this. You can crawl out of that pit of despair. You can overcome this. You can slay this giant and go on to live a life that you love." You know, the pastor went on to say that a lot of people don't know this, but after David slayed Goliath, he was given the princess's hand in marriage. He was given land and horses, jewels and fine robes. He got to live a life beyond his most wild imaginings because he slayed that giant. And the message I leave you with today is that it is the same for each and every one of us. When we go out there and we slay our giants, we are able to live a life that is perfect, perfect for each one of us. Your perfect looks different than mine, but we are able to live a life that's perfect and a life we get up every day to love. So go out there, slay your giants, make it happen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Oh, thank you so much. Wow. Thank you so much. I don't take that lightly. Thank you very much.